It is around 1245 in Paris that my life turned its gaze from political influence. I suddenly grew up. During the course of about a year in prison, I read about him in the press, both national and international. I found him on Wikipedia. I found his name on numerous internet sites. There would be admiring letters that he received in prison, and that must have helped to keep his sanity. Then came the recognition from the Indian Academy of Social Sciences, the Eastern Gold Medal, the Jonathan Mann Award, the 21 Nobel Laureates writing to Prime Minister Manmohan Singh, the demonstrations in India and around the world. But I began feeling guilty and embarrassed. Because of my long absence in Europe since 1970, I learned about Baba's greatness, above all about his work, through his friends and through the name of his admirers from distant lands. I did not know about the hospitals he helped build in Delhi Rajhara, his work in Kadiyari near Bilaspur, the Mitali project, the Rice and Food Cafe. Nor had I heard of his work in Seagull Union for Civil Liberties, or the dedicated band of people that worked with him. The interview with doctors, lawyers, journalists, filmmakers, and a man on the street. The circle of supporters included doctors from all over the world, the most active among them being from foreign teachers and classmates, as well as some who were doctors contemporaries at Christian Medical College level, but had attended the same college. I learned details about this career from his foreign teacher and colleagues at Christian Medical College, which then took on him a full title of awards to recognize his work and exemplify the best ideas of the doctor. There were two images of my brother. The more familiar was of a fantastic man who likes good food, good music, and enjoys walking around with his family and his many good friends. And the other of a serious doctor was concerned. He spent even while he was a student about the health of poorer communities and its roots in their social and economic deprivation. This was his former teacher, Dr. T. Zachariah, who wrote an attribute to his students. Gunnar was a very rare doctor, a man with a deep understanding of the social and political dimensions of health. The governments of the world, the World Bank, and other organizations are now worrying about food security and alternative food policy. Gunnar was gently budgeted at them all. None of his parents moved to the state which refuses to budge from his position. If you ask someone in the government why Dada is in prison, he replied in standard. He is a Maoist leader and sympathizer, and we have enough evidence against him. So I asked the Ministry of Chhattisgarh, why are we not returning the computer seats from Dr. Nilakshan over a year ago, especially since the forensic examination of the artist appears to turn up any incriminating evidence. He said that the forensic institute in Hyderabad would not bring him to a court. When I reminded him that teenagers are hacking into banks and defending him every day, his reply was interesting and basic. I also reminded him that I had heard that not one of the witnesses gave any credible witness or evidence against the liar. He counseled with the possibility of a supplementary charge sheet that was in preparation, based on some 53 pages of telephone conversations with someone who is a known Maoist. Like an astrologer, he predicted that the lower court would probably convict him, but the higher court would believe him. Now, how long the conviction would be is anybody's guess. Common sense tells me that it could be years. Back in the courtroom, my mind suddenly grew up in the noise of what he called the potential of defense lawyer by the penalty. He had just found that the letter had been blasted by the police and had given him the terms that he signed it in. The instant tapping of the typewriter had stopped. The judge looked worried. A letter to a senior Maoist party member which years of gaining had been found among the documents seized from his apartment was printed on a clean sheet of computer paper and did not even have the signature. Moreover, it did not appear in the list of page documents that Dada and the police had pulled at the time they were seized. It was indeed a blast. The old party prosecutor did not bother to look embarrassed. He simply denied any knowledge of it, of how it was there. I left the court dejected and heartbroken as he was driven away the police van. An entire state was conspiring to subject upon that brother a life without a purpose, without any privilege, without any space of his own, denying him the very means of contributing to society in a way that even the state itself had acknowledged, that he had implemented his idea to start an Italian program. They're imposing a punishment upon an innocent man in the full knowledge that they're doing wrong. Now that we are convinced that the imprisonment is based on false and trumped up charges, we will want to know who would want to inflict such a fate on this man, and above all, why. If it could have a possible reason, I refuse to engage in a sensible dialogue with them beyond his belief. My father was once to a very early age wondered why he did not invite the servants in our home to meet with us. At the age of 5, he had a sensitivity to life. I saw a bird in the morning sun flying high up in the sky. A man shot a girl with his gun, and I began to cry. He does not deserve this fate. But for someone who has withstood more than a year and 4 months of prison, solitary confinement, harassment, humiliation, but not shame, we have a simple message. From a feeling that he would have left, my brother.
Yes. by strong will transfer. Direction is there. The enormity of the measures taken by the government in the Bengal for creating some of the services has been a great shock. The view to align the helplessness of opposition to British subjects in India. The disproportionate severity of the punishment inflicted upon the unfortunate people and methods of carrying them out, the evidence of that parallel in the history of the civilized government, by including people's exceptions, reasons, and remorses. Considering that such treatment has been used out to populations disarmed and resourceless by a power which at most fairly efficient organization for the destruction of human life, it must strongly assert that it contained no political expediency, far less moral justification. The accounts of the insults and suffering by our brothers in the Punjab have trickled through the gag silence, reaching every corner of India. The universal agony of this nation, roused to the hearts of our people, has been ignored by our rulers, possibly congratulating themselves for imparting what they imagine as salutary lessons. This callousness has been praised by most of the Anglo-Indian papers, which have, in some cases, gone to brutal lengths of making fun of our sufferings without receiving the least check from the same authority. Relentlessly careful in smothering every cry of pain and judgment from the organs representing the sufferers, knowing that our appeals will be in vain and that the passion of vengeance is building the noble vision of statesmanship in our government, which could so easily afford to be magnanimous, and befitting its physical strength and moral tradition. The very least that I can do for my country is to take all consequences upon myself in giving voice to the protests of the millions of my countrymen, surprised into a dumb anguish of terror. The time has come when badges of honor make our shame glaring in incongruous context of humiliation, and I, for my part, wish to stand short of all special distinction by the sight of those of my countrymen who, for the so-called insignificance, are liable to suffer degradation not this but human beings. And these are the reasons which have compelled me to ask Your Excellency, with due reverence and regret, to relieve me of my title of knighthood, which I had the honor to accept from His Majesty the King, at the hands of your predecessor, for whose nobleness of heart I still extend great admiration. Yours faithfully, Governor of the Board, Rathata, 6th Governor of the Board, May 30th, 1919. Thank you. to the judge, the judge. And he's pushing back.
Thank you.